Hey, welcome church. We're so glad that you're joining us. Wherever you are, we're going to praise God. We're going to give him glory today. Come on. Attention to a baptismal today.
Well, hey church, my name is Britt and I'm one of the pastors at the Elgin campus, and I'm here with my friend Ken. Ready to get baptized?
I'm ready.
Awesome. So Ken, tell us, when was it that you came to know Christ as your Savior?
So I've always felt like life's kind of come easy to me, and through pure will and determination I've been able to kind of force my way through, but I've always kind of had a hole in me. And I've taken the unfortunate thing of drinking alcohol to fill that. And all of a sudden, out of nowhere, it kind of just felt like life wasn't as easy as it used to be. And I felt things kind of crumbling around me. And it was in that moment when things were crumbling around me that I realized I can't do this on my own anymore. So I confessed my sins, asked for forgiveness. And it was kind of watching through church services after that that I could feel the scripture kind of talking directly through me and kind of what the next steps were that I was going to have to take.
Okay, and so there was a moment, actually, like just a few weeks ago, that you embraced Christ personally for your salvation, right?
So the great news was that hole that I was trying to fill all this time, I was able to finally fill with Christ, is what I was able to do.
So you're trusting in Christ alone for your salvation.
I'm trusting in Christ.
Fantastic.
Absolutely.
Well, Ken, that was an amazing decision. What's he been doing in your life since then?
So since then, like I said, that hole I filled with Christ, there's been no more drinking in a month and a half, and I've been able to let that go. And for the first time, Pastor Britt and I had a conversation where he gave me the embarrassing moment of teaching me kind of what sin is on a regular basis. And so it really opened my eyes. And for the first time ever, when I'm thinking about things and how I'm handling things, I think about what would Jesus think, or how would this look in the eyes of the Lord, kind of going forward. And I've been able to take that influence and spread it out amongst my family and friends, and just kind of share with the world the story and kind of where I'm at in life right now.
That is the evidence of Christ in you, changing your desires and wanting the world to know that Christ is the way. It's awesome. So why do you want to be baptized, Ken?
Well, I'm here to publicly profess my faith in Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior.
You've done that. And so, Ken, because of your profession of faith in Christ alone for your salvation, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Welcome, everyone, to Harvest Bible Chapel Online. And I'm Pastor Ed Ollie. Thank you so much for joining us this week. It is such a pleasure to be able to worship God with you today. And we want to welcome you. If you are a guest, maybe you've been with us several times, or this is your first time, we want to say welcome. We don't have visitors at Harvest. We love guests. And we would love to hear where you are joining in from. Maybe you can let us know in the chat or right there at the check-in. Let us know. You can hit that button. We would love to be able to pray for you this week. A couple things that I want to share with you that maybe you don't know about, and this one is very important, so I want you to lean in. We are having online services, but we're going to be making some significant changes this next week. We normally have a Saturday night service at 5 and then Sunday at 9 and 11. But I want to let you know, because we're preparing for some things, we're making some adjustments. There will be no Saturday night service at 5. No Saturday night service. So here's what you can do. You can join us on Sunday at 9 or 11, and you can find out all of those details this next week online in a couple places. One, the social channels for your campus. You can make sure that you can tune in. Your campus pastors will be sharing some details, because each campus has some variations. Or you can look at harvestnow.info, and we'll be placing the information there as well. We want to help serve all of you, those that are eager to get together, as well as those who are wanting to stay home and be safe in their homes. We have something for all of you. That leads me to our regathering update. I know that you're excited. You've been hearing information. We want to share with you this week some details about our regathering. We're thankful for the staff that have been working on this countless hours, and we have some details that we're going to be sharing with you at harvestnow.info. So stay tuned for the information that's coming for our regathering. I want to say thank you also for all of you who have given in this season. We have been so thankful to the Lord of the ways that you have given in your time, your talent, and treasure. There are four ways that you can give, and you can see it right there online. You can give online, you can give via text. You can also give on the mobile app, or you can mail in your offering to the Rolling Meadows campus. Thank you so much for your faithfulness and the ways that you continue to give. So let's pray as we continue in the service. Father, thank you so much for the ways that you've met us. Thank you so much that the ways that you've met us in the book of Mark. And as we continue and move toward the message, I pray that you would be with Pastor Dave Stone, that you would anoint him to share your word, and that we would be able to grow together in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's continue in worship.
not see, you are my strength. No, my heart is weak, you won't let go.
That's right.
You take my place on this battlefield. You go before, you're my sword, my shield.
My heart is set. God, I look to you. I won't be overwhelmed. Give me vision to see things like you do. God, I look to you. You're where my help comes from. Give me wisdom. You know just what to do.
Fragmented messages screaming to get our attention. Our hearts and our minds are broken into fractions. A global pandemic, civil unrest, dividing lines, natural disasters, pain, suffering, fear, lies. We mistake lust for love, tolerance for truth. Materialism's voice is too hard to ignore, as is vanity in its fleeting pursuit. We have labels for all sorts of problems, and we never stop justifying their causes. We forget that God gave us his word for guidance and direction. Instead, we listen with all intention to ourselves, to friends, to the internet, podcasts, television. You see, the enemy claws for our spiritual diversion. And with every moment that our gaze is fixed towards the ground, we press onward in dysfunction. So overwhelmed and weary, looking for answers, solutions, strategies, self-proclaimed revelations. And we settle with whatever we can find to bring peace to our troubled minds. The truth is, there can be no true revelation without death and resurrection. We were given an invitation to seek after a vertical direction. Jesus died so that we could have life, abundance. He says, look up and view life from his perspective. So we need to set our focus, our worship, our affections to the heavens. Because at God's right hand, he is seated. He is the only one that can empower us to walk in freedom. Freedom from guilt, freedom from shame, freedom from pain, our pasts, and addiction, freedom from fear. With Jesus, sin has no power here. We have been bought, sealed, hidden, kept safe and secure. Our spiritual outlook is clear. He is the priority. He is greater than any power, name, title, or authority. So to him, we give all.
Forever on. invite you wherever you are, whatever room you're in, as we sing this next part, just hallelujah, our God reigns. Just lift your hands out. Just lift your hands out as a physical act of saying, God, I commit these words to you and to you alone. There's no one else that deserves this praise and this honor and this glory. Just as Israel reserved that word, hallelujah, for you. Amen. Praise be to Yahweh. God, we reserve this worship for you. Because no one else is deserving of it. No one else is deserving of our hallelujah. No one else is deserving of us to sing that they reign. For it is you and you alone that reign. For it is you and you alone that has the power to save. The enemy trembles at your name, Jesus. And so we exalt your name and your name alone. Speak to us now, God, through your word. Change our hearts, God. Let us fall more in love with you after learning more about who you are and how great you are. It is in the precious name of Jesus that we pray. And wherever you're at, Harvest, just go ahead and say it. Amen.
Amen. Wow, what a great worship time. And we have put God rightly where he belongs on the throne. And we're doing that in worship. The challenge is to continue to do it in our own lives. One of the things I'm excited about is that we have the opportunity to regather. There's a plan that is taking place. And for those of you who are ready to take that next step and you're healthy and willing, it will be great to have you in a church on a campus. And we look forward to that in the days to come when we will get to worship in spirit and truth together. I have a friend who is a professional athlete, and he is very active on social media. He's a Christian. I appreciate the way that he always tries to use his notoriety to pique the curiosity of people toward spiritual conversations. And sometimes when he will post something or when he replies back to someone who has complimented him on some achievement or accomplishment, he will reply back, hashtag IAJ. And when the person sees those capital letters of IAJ, if they're new to following him, they'll ask, what does IAJ stand for? And my friend will reply, it's all Jesus. And what he's saying is this: anything that I have been fortunate enough to accomplish, anything and everything is a blessing from the Lord. It all comes from him. It's all Jesus, just Jesus. So as a church, we have been trying to take the spotlight off of ourselves and fix our eyes on Jesus. It's all Jesus. And so for the past 12 months or so, we have been walking our way through, verse by verse, through the Gospel of Mark. And it's been a fun journey for us, and today we conclude that journey. And we have looked at 678 verses, and today we will end that study. Or maybe we came to the end of Mark last week in my sermon. Well, you hear me say that, and right about now you're thinking, okay, now I am thoroughly confused, because we ended last week with verse 8 in the middle of Mark chapter 16, and we still have Mark 16 verses 9 through 20. So that's going to conclude the study, right? Well, yes and no. That's the answer, because we're going to divide this talk today into four different sections. In the very first section, we'll call the ending of the Gospel of Mark. And we need to talk about this some, because last week we did go all the way through Mark 16 up to verse 8. And for most of you, if you are using the English Standard Version, the ESV, or if you're using the New International Version, the NIV, or a host of other translations, you will notice that in your Bible there is a break right there after the 8th verse. And there might be some statements, maybe to the effect that says the earliest and most reliable manuscripts do not have the next 12 verses. And we could just act like we don't see that warning there and just keep right on reading. But we want to be really forthright as possible as we can be. And we don't want to cut any corners, because if we do, then we'll be tempted to dilute the doctrine and weaken the credibility of the Bible. So while there in the last 12 verses of Mark chapter 16, there is nothing that is inconsistent with any of the other Gospels, nor is there any contradiction, nothing at all. It does still appear that a scribe with a different writing style added those last few verses. So that's important for us to know. So all I'm doing is waving the caution flag to get your attention that this section of a handful of verses may have been added years after Mark had finished writing this. You say, well, why would you say that, Dave? Well, because the earliest and most reliable manuscripts that we have do not contain those 12 verses. Now, that doesn't automatically mean that they aren't original scripture, but it does raise questions as to why they appeared in later manuscripts and not in earlier manuscripts. I mean, simple logic would agree with that. And most theologians think that the final verses don't read like the rest of Mark's writings. Michael Van Lanningham, Harvest theologian in residence, we call him Dr. V, he believes that Mark's gospel actually ends with verse 8, right where we ended last week. And that was the verse that speaks of the women who have just encountered an angel in the tomb explaining that Jesus is risen. So listen to the very next verse, verse 8. And they went out and fled from the tomb, for trembling and astonishment had seized them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. Now, there's no reason for your faith to be shaken over this. In fact, it should actually cause you to be glad that there are some checks and balances. And if there are red flags, or in this case, a yellow flag, we should call them to your attention so that you can make your own informed decision. Back over in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 15, Paul writes, "Do your best to present yourself to God as one approved, a workman who has no need to be ashamed, rightly handling the word of truth." And that's what we want to do, because some of these manuscript issues regarding the authenticity of these alternative endings here in Mark, that are usually regarded as the last verse of the Gospel of Mark, most people think that this really is the end, verse 8. So why end this particular book with verse 8, this verse that says that women left the tomb and they were afraid, so they didn't tell anybody what it was that they had seen? That seems like a rather awkward place in order to pick up the story. Why end there? Well, let's admit that it is rather anticlimactic, right? But I think there are four possible explanations for Mark ending right there at that point. Number one is that the ending was lost. Maybe the last part of the manuscript was lost prior to copying it. Or number two, the gospel was never finished. For some reason, Mark got busy or he lost interest and he just never got time to do it. And number three, Mark passed away while he was writing the conclusion. So he dies right there in the middle of writing a paragraph. Or number four, Mark intentionally ended the gospel in an open-ended fashion. He wrote it with an ambiguous conclusion for a reason. So let's look at each of these explanations. Number one, they probably didn't lose the last page of this, because actually it was probably written on a scroll and it was probably all one piece and it was a continuous document. Well, what about the second option, that the gospel was never finished? Well, that seems a little bit far-fetched, that God could speak the solar system into existence and have a Bible recorded through the inspiration of his Holy Spirit through 40 different authors over a span of 1,500 years of 66 books, and yet one of them was missing about three paragraphs. That doesn't really sound consistent with a God who has the power to bring people back from the dead. Well, maybe it's the third option, that Mark drops dead in the middle of writing the last couple of paragraphs. But I think God probably would have seen that coming. And he probably would have made provision, or he may have somehow impressed on Mark to start writing a little bit earlier. But the reality is that the two most reliable and respected early manuscripts of the book of Mark do not include Mark 16, 9 through 20. So in my mind, I think that the fourth option seems to be the most logical conclusion, that Mark intentionally ended the gospel right here in open-ended fashion. Let me read it for you again. Imagine this being the last verse of the entire book. And they went out, talking about the women, and fled from the tomb, for trembling and astonishment had seized them, and they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. Authors and screenwriters would say that it's not anticlimactic or ambiguous. They would just say it's open-ended for a reason. You see, there's literary power in ending the gospel so abruptly that the readers are now drawn into the story itself. The readers, years later, we must now ask ourselves, what will I do with Jesus? Will I clam up out of fear and not say a word to others about Jesus, or will I openly share my faith? The first thing that these ladies did was they were fearful. And in trembling, they left that tomb. And it says they didn't tell people. But we know what happens, and all of the readers of the Gospel of Mark know what happened as well, that they did open their mouth. It may have taken some time. It may have been some time after they saw the disciples, but they eventually did. But you're drawn into the story. What will I do? What would I do if I were one of those women? If I do not accept him as a suffering king, I will not experience the benefits of him as a resurrected king. Think of it like this. Have you ever gone to a theater to watch a movie with a group of your friends? And so travel back in time in order for this illustration to pre-COVID, all right? And you go with a group of friends to watch a movie, and usually in most movies, like a Disney or a Hallmark movie, every loose end gets tied up together, and the hero or the couple go walking off into the sunset, and everything comes out together nicely and neatly. But there are other times when the movie leaves you hanging, or the last scene allows you to decide or determine in your own mind how things will play out. And so now as you walk to the car with your buddies, you are pulled in and you must decide. And then your decision serves to market and promote others seeing the movie as you talk about it. And they say, well, tell me about it. Well, you know, I don't know if you'll like the conclusion because you've got some decisions that you've got to make. And it's likely that that's what happened here. That's what Mark is doing with this ending. It's not an accident. He intentionally makes his last line one of how the women felt when they left the tomb. And since Mark writes this some 25 years later after the resurrection, and since the gospel has exploded with the number of Christians growing, it is already obvious to the Roman Christians, his intended audience, that these women didn't stay silent for long about Christ's resurrection, but they told the disciples, and after that they told everyone that they possibly could. And so the question that Mark is posing to you, the reader, is this: what are you going to do with Jesus Christ? And with this final verse, he's bringing the topic front and center before you. What are you going to do with this message of the Messiah? And when we look at those last dozen verses that may have been added by a well-meaning scribe or some other follower of Christ, you can rest assured that, generally speaking, these verses and experiences do appear elsewhere in other gospels. So personally, I just want you to know that I probably won't lose a whole lot of sleep over this. In fact, I probably won't lose any sleep over this, because the rest of the verses are still consistent with what other gospels say. For instance, verse 9 says that Jesus appeared first to Mary Magdalene. Well, John chapter 20, verse 11, tells us all about that. And through verses 17, it describes exactly how that happened. And then in John chapter 20, verse 18, it says, Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, I have seen the Lord, and that he had said these things to her. Mark chapter 16, verse 12, talks about Jesus appearing to two people on a long walk. And that fits perfectly with the account that we studied this past Easter, the story in Luke chapter 23, as Jesus walks and talks with two men on the road to Emmaus. The next verse in Mark 16 goes on to talk about Jesus appearing to the 11 disciples. And that is also substantiated in Luke's gospel in the 24th chapter and also in John chapter 20. And after that is the account of the ascension and Jesus' last words before being taken up to heaven. And in Mark, in chapter 16, verses 15 and 16, it speaks of believing in Jesus and humbling yourself by being baptized into him, just as you saw Ken just do that. What an awesome moment. And again, Matthew's gospel speaks of the same thing when Jesus shares the Great Commission. And the language in Mark is quite similar. Well, let's move to the second section that I want us to look at, and that is what we'll call a recap of the Gospel of Mark. And what we have learned throughout this book, it's the shortest gospel written, is that it is very clear and it is very to the point. It's a book of action. And that's why throughout it he uses words like immediately and straightway. It was written sometime between 55 and 65 AD. It was primarily, as I mentioned earlier, written for Roman Christians. And Mark recorded more miracles than any other gospel writer. And his goal seems to be to prove that Jesus is the Messiah, and he validates that by mentioning the miracles that Jesus performed. I was looking back at some of the different sections that we talked about in our Just Jesus sermon series, and as we have progressed through this book of Mark, we began this series with a sub-series that we called Come and See. Come and See. And early in his ministry, Jesus invited people to come and see, to listen to his message, to check out what he was teaching and the kingdom of God, what it was all about. And when we came to the end of Mark chapter 4, we moved into another section that we just called All Authority. And through those messages, we heard and read of how Jesus validated that he has authority and power over nature and over demons and over illness and over your past. And from there, we began to see Jesus as a radical teacher in Mark chapters 7 through 10. And I marvel at his ability to speak to the heart of people. And you'll recall that listeners spoke of how Jesus shared a new teaching and that he taught with a new authority. Mark chapter 1, verse 22. And they were astonished at his teaching, for he taught them as one who had authority and not as the scribes. We then transitioned into the section we called the bold servant. And that also gave us our theme verse for the entire book, and we challenge you to memorize it and for it to be a goal for your own life. Mark chapter 10, verse 45, for even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. And in our final 8 weeks of this study, we saw Jesus as the suffering king. And as we walked through the final days leading up to and including his death, his burial, and his resurrection, we learned more about what Jesus went through for us. And his resurrection is so important. You know, last week I invited you to share a brief video with your church family of maybe a takeaway or a learning that you had gleaned from the Just Jesus series. And I want to thank all of you all who sent one of those in to us. Let me share some of those with you right now. Watch this with me for the next few minutes.
I'm John Kilner from the Deerfield Road campus. Throughout Mark, I was impressed by the love and the patience that Jesus had toward the bumbling disciples. It assured me that there's hope for people like me and inspired me to be more patient and loving toward others.
What I learned from the book of Mark is that Jesus Christ is the one and only true Savior for mankind, that he lived a perfect life as God on the earth, that he sacrificed himself for our sins as God on the cross, and that he rose from the dead as God into heaven because he's still the King.
Hi, my name is John Smith. I'm from the Rolling Meadows campus. I was deeply impacted by the Just Jesus Bold Servant series. His example of the way that he loved and cared for his neighbors and those in his community. I want to be better about that in the days ahead.
Hi, I'm Debbie from Des Plaines, Illinois, and I learned through the Just Jesus series that it's impossible to love the neighbors that I can see around me without first being fully devoted to loving the God that I can't see.
Hey, I'm Tom Madison. I live in Elgin, Illinois, and in the Just Jesus series, I loved when Pastor Ed Ollie was talking about the Pharisees and the scribes and how they were full-time pastors, and I don't want to just be a full-time pastor. I want to be a full-time Christian, and that really spoke to me during this season of life.
My name is Heidi Frailer, and I attend the Deerfield Road campus. While teaching on communion, Dave Stone said, "The world drinks to forget, and the Christian drinks to remember." Thank you for that truth, Dave.
I've loved going through Mark. I feel like I've gotten to know Jesus better and his confidence in the way that he carried himself. I especially think of when he healed Jairus' daughter while he was still speaking, she was healed. And then he marvels at another person's faith. And this study has made me want to be someone who Jesus would marvel at my faith and encouraged me to dig in to be that person.
Hi, my name is Sherry Smith and I attend the Rolling Meadows campus. And when I think back on the Just Jesus series, one of the takeaways I have is the message from December, power over my past. Satan knows my name, but he calls me by my sin. Where Jesus knows my sin and he still calls me by my name.
Hi, my name is Ron and I attend the Deerfield Road campus. One of the learnings I received from the Just Jesus series from the Book of Mark was only when I let go of what God has given me can I receive what God has for me.
Hi, this is Lauren from the Rolling Meadows campus, and the Just Jesus series taught me the importance of having a daily time where I go and I get away with God the Father. And we see that in Mark chapter 1, that even Jesus had to get alone and go to a place where he knew no one else would be and just meet with God.
Hello, Harvest. I'm Jeff King from the Deerfield Road campus. And one of the biggest takeaways that I had is a reminder that when things are at their worst, God is always at his best.
At Calvary, when it seemed that things were at their worst, God was at his best. Showing his love on the cross and his power in the tomb, which turned out to be more like a two-night stay at a motel rather than a long-term burial plot. The grave couldn't keep our king, and yet death was no match for the miracle worker. And the Bible tells us of multiple appearances to the disciples and to many others who had seen him during his ministry. In fact, the Apostle Paul tells us, this is really cool, in 1 Corinthians. I'm so glad that Paul records this for us. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 6. Listen to what it is that Paul says. It says, then he appeared to more than 500 brothers at one time, most of whom are still alive. Jesus was no mere man. This was God in the flesh. And before Jesus left us, he promised us the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit that would live inside of everyone who commits their life to the Lord. And that leads us to the third section, if you're taking notes, and that is the peace and hope that we find in Jesus. So let me take you back to two separate conversations that Jesus has with his disciples. Conversation number one takes place in the upper room with them, just about a dozen hours before Jesus is nailed to a cross. What does he say to them in that setting leading up to his death? And we find it in John chapter 14, verse 27. Jesus says, peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. Jesus says, what I'm going to give to you is different than what the world offers. Years ago, I was speaking somewhere in Indiana, and I was waiting to go up to preach, and I was seated out in the congregation, and the guy who was introducing me said this, said, Dave Stone is a warm individual and a model preacher. And I sat there and thought, wow, that was very kind of him. I really appreciate that. And then he went on to say, well, let me explain what I mean by that. Warm means not so hot, and model means a cheap imitation of the real thing. And with that, I was introduced to come up and speak. So that will get your attention quickly, right? But what was happening there? Well, he was saying that this guy is not so hot and he's not the greatest preacher that you're ever going to have. What Jesus is saying is this: my gifts are different than what the world gives. Mine are genuine. The world has a cheap imitation. It's a knockoff version. You see, back then, peace was a commodity that every leadership structure tried to promise if the subjects submitted. But what Jesus is promising is very different from the world. It's peace through his presence. It's peace through the coming of the Holy Spirit. It's real, it's genuine, it's eternal. It goes deeper than your circumstances. So prior to his death, Jesus says that through the Holy Spirit, he says, peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Now, to be real candid with you, this verse loses a little bit of something in the English when we look at it. Here in the English, where it says, "Peace I leave with you," in essence, what he's saying is that the wording is literally, "This is what I bequeath to you." You say, bequeath? Well, that's a fancy or a morbid term, right? Why would Jesus talk like that? Well, it's because he knows that in about 18 hours, he will be dead. And so he says, "This is what I want to leave behind to you. Guys, you're going to need it." Now think about that in an earthly sense. What did Jesus have to bequeath or pass on to his disciples? He didn't have a house. He didn't have any financial portfolio. There was no walk-in closet with real trendy, fashionable clothes. From an earthly perspective, he didn't have prestige or he didn't have clout to pass on. I mean, any chance of that goes out the window when the very next day he dies a criminal's death, hanging stark naked on a cross. So that's a no on the prestige and the clout. So what is the one thing that Jesus could bequeath to his followers? Peace. Just peace. Peace I leave with you. Peace I give to you. And it's not as the world gives. The type of peace that Jesus is offering and leaving behind is the peace that comes through the Holy Spirit, is the kind of peace that will get him through a wrongful arrest, false charges, soldier brutality, 6 illegal trials in the middle of the night, and an early morning beating within an inch of his life. It's a type of peace that comes from the Holy Spirit that will empower him to stay on the cross, even though he has the power to come down from the cross. And so just hours prior to that cross, the one thing that he knows that they will desperately need is the one thing that he generously offers them. He bequeaths them peace. And ironically, what the disciples needed at that time is the very thing that we all need right now in 2020. And through the personal indwelling of the Holy Spirit that lives inside of every believer, Jesus offers us something that has staying power, that is greater than our circumstances, that is stronger than any virus, that has the ability to unite a divided country, that can outlast any pandemic. Let's complete the bookend. Let's look at conversation number 2. It's when Jesus makes his first appearance to the disciples. First time he's seen them since Thursday night when he just said to them, "Peace, I leave with you." And it's on Sunday night now, and he's in a room, and after the weekend of his death, burial, and resurrection, in John chapter 20, verses 19 through 21, it says, "On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, 'Peace be with you.' And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. And then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. And Jesus said to them again, 'Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you.'" There it is again. Peace be with you. The one thing they needed was the one thing he offered, peace. So how do you respond when things seem to be out of your control and you face adversity? When your spouse files for divorce but you want to reconcile? When you lose your job due to no fault of your own? When your child wants to go to the school but the authorities say, "Not yet"? When you want to regather at church but you live with someone who has a health issue? When there's tension with a coworker, do you keep looking to Jesus for your source of hope? His resurrection is a game changer. When you are hopeless, you can find hope in him. His resurrection helps you rise above the adversity and uncertainty in these trying times, because this earthly life isn't all there is, and suffering and death do not have the final say. Nothing can separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Well, here's the fourth section, the final section. Our response to the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's the section. What is our response to the gospel of Jesus Christ? The death, the burial, and the resurrection should dramatically change the way that you make your choices, that you live out your faith. It should change the way that you raise your children and the way you approach every day of your life. And so it seems that the conclusion of Mark, whether it's in verse 8 or whether it's in verse 20, whether it's open-ended or whether it's neatly tied together, it still is begging a question. And the question is, what are you personally going to do with Jesus Christ? Are you going to keep the message of Jesus to yourself for fear of being ridiculed or ostracized? Or will you become a person of action, as Mark is encouraging us to become? And let me just implore you to boldly open your mouth and share of how Jesus has changed your life. And obey Jesus' command in Mark chapter 28, verses 19 and 20, the Great Commission. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you, and behold, I am with you always to the end of the age. You know that passage, Harvest. That has been a theme passage for this church for years. And we could summarize Jesus' command into four simple words: go, teach, baptize, teach. We continue to mature. We continue to be taught. We continue to seek growth. It's ongoing. We don't arrive because we become a Christian. We want to deepen and we want to mature and look more like Jesus today than we did last week. And I hope that you have enjoyed the Just Jesus series as we've walked through the Gospel of Mark. And yet you need to know that Jesus is all throughout the pages of this Bible. And we see his presence and we see his faithfulness in every book in the New Testament. And we see Jesus even in the Old Testament as well. It's all Jesus. Jesus is the story of and in the Bible. And the Gospel of Mark isn't the only place that you will find him. In Genesis, Jesus is the ram at Abraham's altar. In Exodus, he is the Passover lamb. In Leviticus, he is the high priest. In Numbers, he is the cloud by day and the pillar of fire by night. In Deuteronomy, he's our city of refuge. In Joshua, he is a scarlet thread outside of Rahab's window. In Judges, he is our judge. In Ruth, he is our kinsman redeemer. In 1 and 2 Samuel, he is our trusted prophet. In Kings and Chronicles, he is our reigning king. In Ezra, he is our faithful scribe. In Nehemiah, he is the rebuilder of everything that is broken. In Esther, he is the Mordecai sitting right there, faithful at the gate. In Job, he's our redeemer who lives. In Psalms, he is our shepherd, and I shall not want. In Proverbs and Ecclesiastes, he is our wisdom. In the Song of Solomon, he is our bridegroom. In Isaiah, he is the wonderful counselor, the mighty God, the everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace, who was wounded for your transgressions. In Jeremiah and Lamentations, Jesus is the weeping prophet. In Ezekiel, he is the wonderful four-faced man. In Daniel, he is the fourth man in the fiery furnace. And in Hosea, he is the picture of faithfulness. In Joel, he baptizes us with the Holy Spirit. In Amos, he's our burden bearer. In Obadiah, he's our Savior. And in Jonah, he's our great foreign missionary who takes the Word of God all around the world. In Micah, he is the messenger with beautiful feet. In Nahum, he is the avenger. In Habakkuk, he's the watchman who is ever praying for revival. In Zephaniah, he is the Lord, mighty to save. In Haggai, he is the restorer of our lost heritage. In Zechariah, he is an overflowing fountain. In Malachi, he is the Son of Righteousness with healing in his wings. We come to the New Testament, and in Matthew, he is the Son of the living God. And in Mark, you've come to know him as a miracle worker. And Luke, he is the Son of Man. And John, he's the door by which every one of us must enter. In Acts, Jesus is the shining light that appeared to Saul on the road to Damascus. In Romans, he is our justifier. In 1 Corinthians, he is our resurrection. In 2 Corinthians, he is our sin bearer. In Galatians, he redeems us from the law. In Ephesians, he is our unsearchable riches. In Philippians, he supplies our every need. In Colossians, he is the fullness of the Godhead in bodily form. In 1 and 2 Thessalonians, we find him to be our soon and coming King. In 1 and 2 Timothy, he is the mediator between God and man. In Titus, he is our blessed hope. And in Philemon, he is a friend who sticks closer than a brother. And in Hebrews, he is the great high priest. In James, it is the Lord who heals the sick. And in 1 and 2 Peter, he is the chief shepherd. In 1, 2, and 3 John, it is Jesus who models the tenderness of love. And in Jude, he is the Lord coming with 10,000 saints. And in Revelation, lift up your eyes, O church, for your redemption is near. For he is the Alpha and the Omega. He is the beginning and the end. He is the King of kings. He is the Lord of lords. It's all Jesus. This entire book, it's all Jesus.
Jesus, Jesus, yesterday, today, forever, you're the same. Everlasting, never failing, yesterday, today, forever, you're the same. Oh, Jesus, Jesus, yesterday, today, forever, you're the same. Everlasting, never failing, yesterday, today, forever, you're the same. Jesus, Jesus, yesterday, today, forever, you're the same.
Yes, you are.
Everlasting, never failing, yesterday, today, forever, you're the same. Yesterday, today, forever, you're the same. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you'll always be. It's Jesus. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you
maybe in your life, it's all Jesus wouldn't be a true description of your life or your pursuits. I understand that. The Bible tells us that God is a jealous God. So let me restate the question for you one more time. What are you personally going to do with Jesus Christ? Will you choose him apart from all of the other distractions that are begging for your time and allegiance? You know, you'll need to have a single-minded focus when you make that choice. It has to be just Jesus. And you can begin that journey by praying to God. And after you've done that, I just would encourage you just to grab your mobile device and just to text the word follow to 797979. And if you just text that word follow to that number, that will give you a chance to talk with someone. You can begin that journey. We'd love to have one of our pastors just have the chance to encourage you and pray with you and help you in your walk. Thanks so much for worshiping with us today. Don't put off making that decision. And remember to watch your email or the website here at church for details about which campuses will be regathering and when they will be doing that. And remember, you are loved.